Maurice Wolin made TCAP history on a sunny August day back in the year 2006. A practicing medical doctor, the 48-year-old man made plans for sex with a perverted justice decoy pretending to be 13. This video will explore the different elements of communication that were exhibited during the sting, although I'll be doing a fair amount of shit-talking as well. So without any further ado, let's see some righteous justice befall one of the most ridiculous predators to ever be wrangled by Chris Hansen.
So far, you've met men in the military, men in the computer industry.
This guy's coming in. That can be
and
the
then
doctor.
Before we even get into it, it's worth noting that this guy lied to the decoy about multiple things. He told the decoy that he was 29 years old and that his name was Marco. His name is not Marco and he was not 29. He was 48 at the time of the sting. And this guy looks exactly like you'd expect some fucking perverted ass 48-year-old doctor to look like.
But if there was a list of the most respected members of the community, a cancer research doctor would probably be in the list of the most respected members of the community. A cancer research doctor would probably
there. So despite what Chris is saying, like Chris is just going on about him being a cancer research doctor, but Chris fails to acknowledge this crazy predator look back that this guy gives off. He was extremely worried that this was a setup. He had talked multiple times about how scared he was and how anxious he was about the entire situation to the decoy. The decoy had to like settle his anxiety. Like the decoy was actively trying to like assuage how fucking nervous this guy was. And his look back is just an acknowledgement of the fact that he knows what he's doing is wrong. He knows what he's doing is illegal. And he's trying to make sure that no one is going to fucking witness him going into the house.
Near the top.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Could it be?
So,
this decoy's so good.
Not bad of a drive?
Well.
Oh, here we go. That was like a commercial.
This guy's coming in.
So he's just sauntering up to the exactly.
Go to Mark 3. Have him come towards you.
There we go. Well, another capture of the epic predator look back of Maurice Wolin.
Hey, you made it. Come on back.
Thanks. Yeah, come on back.
Good. How are you?
This decoy was great. Rochelle, this decoy, like, she has some epic lines where another predator, she was all, I got a surprise for you. Like, this decoy was one of the more confident and assertive ones. I think it's funny.
He's 48 years old, married, and a prominent San Francisco physician.
Yeah,
so Maurice Wolin was exactly, he was married, he had daughters, and not only was he a practicing medical doctor, he was a oncologist, so he had a specialty within the practice of medicine. He did cancer research, which must be an immensely difficult job. Like the amount of chemistry and the amount of just science that you'd be doing in a position like that, it necessitates a certain level of intellect. I think it's pretty much beyond argument that this guy is at least capable of complex tasks. Like he's probably one of the more intelligent predators that were ever featured on the show. And you can't be a doctor if you're not intelligent. You just simply you won't be able to excel in a complicated field like that where there's a lot of rigorous thinking and there's a lot of ruling out and probability. Like you couldn't do that if you weren't a somewhat intelligent or I would argue very intelligent person.
It's hard to believe that someone of his stature would show up to meet a girl who said she was 13.
But I don't think, dude, if you watch the fucking news, it shouldn't actually be that surprising that someone of that stature is trying to do this shit. There are predators from all walks of life, politicians, religious figures, and there have been since the beginning of history. Like, humanity's pretty fucked, and I don't think there are too many people arguing otherwise in 2020.
Into the backyard where she invites him to go in her hot tub.
Pour me a drink.
He met the girl online 3 days earlier.
Oh my god.
The girl was really a perverted justice decoy pretending to be 13. Using the screen name Tall Dreamy Dot, he lies.
Right,
and says,
and so the screen name too, the fact that he would just put Tall Dreamy Doc on his screen name. He advertised online in multiple ways. Like even before doing this video, I did a little bit of research on this fucker. I found a profile on like a fucking sugar daddy website where he immediately puts that he's a doctor. I don't know if that was actually him or if that's just like someone who's trolling his ass, but from what I've seen online, like in both of the dialogues that he had, because he talked to two different decoys, in both of the dialogues, he must have, like, he tells them that he's a doctor just by his very screen name. So anyone who would interact with them, like, they would automatically know, or they would at least assume that this dude is a doctor. And of course, if a person's a doctor, we can make further assumptions. Like, okay, if they're a doctor, they must be probably smart. They must probably make a decent amount of money. They must be held to a certain ethical standard of practice. Like they're accountable to certain individuals. So he's very quick to advertise things that would be enticing. Maurice Wolin is aware enough of just humans. He has enough sense when it comes to communicating with people to understand that he wasn't born with the best genetics, that he doesn't have, you know, like this athletic build or charisma, but he does have money and he does have status. So he understands and he panders to that.
He's 29. Remember, he's really 48.
Yeah, he's lying. Of course, he says he's fucking 29. I don't know what he was going to say. Like, the fucking decoy would have thought that this dude is like Barca's dad.
What bra size do you wear? She says 30B, but it's kind of big on me right now. I'm still growing. He replies, I will kiss them.
Yeah.
He goes into
that's
graphic...
That's intent. And then the legal argument that this guy tried to make in court is fucking absurd. I'll go into it later, but it's pretty ridiculous, especially after you see what he had sent in the chat multiple times to hear what his defense was later on.
About giving and receiving oral sex. And later says, I'm horny for you.
Yeah.
And asks her to masturbate while thinking of
yeah,
him.
Yeah, he was a predator.
He tells her
this dude, multiple times throughout the chat, he brings up sex and he tries to make it seem like he's talking to the decoy about other shit. And then he just constantly reverts back to sex talk.
Several times, he could get into trouble. But it isn't enough to stop him from coming over.
I could get into trouble. I love that. That's a hilarious line. I could get into big trouble. If you just read it with pausing, like, it adds so much more emphasis to the statement. That's interesting. I used to be a competitive speaker, like debate stuff, and like the use of pause is so effective. Like, just when you're talking, like, I could get into trouble. I could get into big trouble. Like, that pause puts so much more meaning onto the sentence.
Could get into trouble, but it isn't enough to stop him from coming over and helping himself to a drink.
Gravity. This dude gets fucking cock-blocked by gravity.
So where are you coming from?
San Francisco.
Oh, okay.
He's nervous. He's completely frazzled.
So where are you coming
from? To a drink.
And then we can see this fucking metamorphosis. So look at his posture now. He's fairly relaxed. He has this pitcher up that he's holding. It's probably straining his arm. Like, he's using all of the fucking muscles in his arm. He's trying not to express the fucking strain, the physical exertion that he's undergoing in pouring this with one hand. But he's smiling. He's leaning forward. This dude's happy. This dude's relaxed. This guy's relaxed. He's happy. He thinks he's fucking won the jackpot. He thinks that he's gonna show up, have sex with this 13-year-old, and then just dip out. And he thinks that he's gonna be able to get away with it. And then we could see how quickly those dreams and that fantasy gets fucking dashed upon the rocks.
And helping himself to a drink.
Boom. Jeez. And then there comes the other hand. He didn't want to use it. Yeah, he didn't want to use it. He had to use it, though.
So where are you coming from?
San Francisco.
And he's frazzled.
Oh, okay.
See, like, obviously, what he's doing is wrong, but, like, if you were just on a date with, like, a woman who was your age and something like this happened, like, obviously, you would just play it off like it was funny. Like, there's no need for a person to just get really fucking, like, self-conscious. Like, I think this just goes to show that he was not a very confident person. He could have very easily played this off in a way that was humorous, but he failed to do that. He was unable.
So where are you coming from?
Since I made a mess.
San Francisco.
I wonder if that's because in his home, making a mess is like a big deal. Like, in my home, like, yeah, I don't really trip if I make a mess. Like, I'm kind of a slob. But if I spill something, like, I'll clean it up eventually. But, like, cleaning it up is not like my... Sometimes, like, I'll just make a mess and, like, I won't clean it up immediately. Like, it doesn't stress me out. But he must come in his home. He must really... have to maintain a clean atmosphere. In his work, he must have to maintain a clean atmosphere, but this is probably just a reflection of his conscientiousness, of the way that he lives his life.
Okay. Oh yeah, so there probably was a lot of traffic, huh?
He's nervous. As the doctor looks for a towel, he spots Dateline's camera crew.
They got say here. Chris, later on in like the fucking raw footage, like Chris indicates that there's eye contact. Like, not only does he see a camera person like holding a fucking big ass bazooka camera, like they make eye contact. That must have been incredibly fucking awkward.
Sir, I need a towel. Do you have a towel?
As the doctor looks for a towel, he spots Dateline's camera crew.
I gotta take off. One of the most epic lines in TCAM. I gotta take off.
I need to talk to you for a minute.
He runs, but he doesn't
get
very far.
Yeah, he's walking
far.
Quick. Oh. And then here. Boom. Why he does that? Why? It's like he wanted to just make a metaphor. He wanted to just have some kind of symbolic action to represent the destruction of his life. It's like each one of the pieces of those sunglasses, each shard that fragmented off, it could just be one individual aspect of his life that's just been fucking smashed to pieces. Like his job, his research, his marriage, like all these elements of his life that were just immediately thrown to shit.
I wasn't gonna do anything.
Yeah, so as soon as you're arrested, it doesn't matter what you say. Like, when cops look at you with intent, like, you're going to jail. If a cop suspects you of a crime, like an actual crime, you're going to jail. Good luck talking your way out of getting arrested. Like, it's not within the scope of a police officer's job to decide whether you did something or not. Like, the police officer is just going to say, I saw you do this. Like they're not the person who actually decides. It's going to be a judge or a jury who's going to actually decide the guilt or innocence of your actions. So it's kind of funny. He must have known a certain amount about the United States legal system. He goes into how he'd never been in trouble before, but even if you had never been personally arrested, like anyone who's a doctor, you have to work within the law. Like there's a lot of legal shit within the medical field that you have to adhere to, like certain regulations and like regulatory boards. So he must have a very good understanding of the law as it relates to medicine, but it seems that he's woefully fucking unprepared for even like a basic fucking lesson in criminal defense.
I wasn't gonna do anything.
And this is great. That's one of the most hilarious fucking images in all of TCAP, I think. Here we have a fucking cancer doctor, a person who probably made about maybe $200,000 or $300,000 a year. Someone who was within a small percentage of the population who easily breaks six figures consistently. And here we have him fucking face down one glass, right? That would just be one fucking metaphorical piece of his life that's fallen apart. But we have him, these two cops, and then this other guy just pointing down. This must have been an extremely uncomfortable position too. Like this dude's lanky ass arms are just being shoved down. He probably posed very little physical threat. And the officers must have known that this guy was not going to be someone who was going to fight. I mean, even if he tried to fight, like he's not very strong, so he could be easily subdued by like one officer. But aside from just how physically weak he is, he's also a fucking doctor. Like a doctor is so unlikely to like engage in a behavior that's going to get them fired. Well, obviously, right, from what he did, but even in engaging with violence, like doctors are probably far more unlikely to just like engage in a bar fight, because even something as seemingly benign as a bar fight, like that could lead to you losing your medical license. And if you lose your medical license, you've just wasted hundreds of thousands of dollars and countless hours of your life. So it's like these dudes who have or anybody who has a professional career, like fuck, that makes me think about me. Like I want to be a lawyer. I am studying for the LSAT right now, and it's like these videos I make, I guess law schools and other like eventual clients could see these fucking videos and like have a negative impression. It's whatever, I guess, but yeah, that's just the reality of like working in a professional field like this.
Get his keys. I wasn't doing anything.
wasn't doing anything.
Man, I wasn't doing anything.
Get his keys.
He's breaking down.
And like
he can't
all the other men
it.
Caught in this investigation, from used car salesmen to engineers to Marines, he goes through the same procedure.
He is tripping.
First stop, the booking station.
What am I being booked for?
Physiologically, he must be undergoing such extreme stress. The back of his neck is probably very fucking hot. He's probably starting to sweat. He's probably starting to sweat under his armpits. We can't really see. He probably has goosebumps. He's right now going into a state of shock that is probably something that he's never experienced before in his life.
I call my wife. You can do that after this booking procedure.
That's why he wants to. I mean, I guess it's actually sad that his first instinct is to call his wife. It's like, dude, you're exactly like you're married. This is a betrayal on two levels. Not only are you betraying society by trying to have sex with someone who's a 13-year-old, you're betraying your wife and your marriage. That's fucked. And the fact that the first thought that he has is, oh, let me go run back to my wife to save this. That just goes to show how fucking selfish this guy is.
He asks routine personal questions, but the doctor appears distracted. Nothing sinking in.
Yeah, so
you're gonna talk to a detective.
Yeah, explain that to him already. He's failing to
he's failing to come. So in communication, my undergraduate degree is in communication studies. Like, one of the things that can prevent a person from understanding a message is referred to as noise. Like, in the communication in interpersonal communication, where there's two people talking, like if you're talking to someone and they're very drunk, if they're just like blackout drunk and you're trying to explain to them like some fucking math, like a math concept or something, they're probably not going to be able to pay attention, right? Because of their inebriation. In communication, we'd call that noise. Like, we'd call the inebriation that prevents understanding noise. Or it could be being hungry. If you're trying to like listen to someone talk about some bullshit and you're just really hungry and you're like, dude, I'm not even listening. Like, that would be noise. So Wolin is experiencing intrapersonal noise. So it's an element of communication that's occurring within himself. It's just the anxiety that he's experiencing, the noise, is preventing him from understanding the messages that the cops are giving to him.
Really scared.
Yeah, he's scared.
Scared about.
Nothing scared about.
No. I'm somebody who has.
Cops will always lie to you, dude. Cops will fucking lie to you like nothing.
Anything in my life, okay. He died a traffic ticket, and you wouldn't be scared.
How do you never get a traffic ticket? Well, that's fucking crazy. That just boggles my mind. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe it's because I'm just like, I've been a kind of person who is like smoking weed and like fucking around my whole life. Like, I've gotten a lot of tickets and like have had other bullshit interactions with cops. Like, it's kind of crazy that this dude has never. So is it that he never breaks like the rules of the road, or that he never gets caught? I wonder. Let me know in the comments what you think below. Since Maurice Wolin has never gotten a traffic ticket, does that mean, well, actually, so if we think about this, Maurice Wolin bragged in the chat log that he had a car, a fucking Mercedes SL550. He bragged that he had that car that went 180 miles an hour. So did he drive 180 miles an hour? Because that's breaking the law. Then it's just that he never got caught. So I wonder if he was bullshitting to the decoy that he even went that fast or what. But it's interesting. It's interesting to think about.
Trouble, obviously.
Yeah, I'm in.
Like, why? So you're gonna talk about having this extremely fast car, and then you're gonna tell this hypothetical 13-year-old that you like to drive fast in this car, and then when you get caught up, you're gonna fucking cry to the cops and say you've never had a speeding ticket. Like, were you just lying, bro? Were you fucking fronting to this? Oh, I guess he was, and we shouldn't be surprised. You know, he said he was a 29-year-old named Marco.
I feel like I'm in big trouble, and I feel
yeah,
like
you are in big trouble.
I made maybe a mistake, but I didn't do anything.
And how could you?
He's Dr.
If you made a mistake, then you obviously did something. The something that you did was the mistake. Like, it doesn't even make logical sense to say that I made a mistake, but I didn't do it. Let's see what he says.
You're in some trouble, obviously.
Yeah, I'm in. I feel like I'm in big trouble, and I feel like I made maybe a mistake, but I didn't do anything.
I made maybe a mistake, but I didn't do anything. And then he has this qualifier. I made maybe a mistake. No, you made a mistake. You know you made a mistake, and your mistake is the thing that you did. Like, he's not being charged with having sex with anyone. He's going to be charged with intent. And he is, what he's done is sufficient to warrant an intent charge.
He's Dr. Maurice Wolin, head of clinical research and medical affairs for a pharmaceutical company. And he's not happy about seeing
head of research. Wow. See, yeah. So this dude, not only did he work in cancer research, so he had kind of a prestigious position within. It's just crazy that he was willing to throw all this away.
I'm here in handcuffs. I have pictures being taken of me left and right. I don't know what I'm being accused of.
Yes, he does. He knows exactly. Dude, it's not like you're being accused of like drugs or something. Like, he may not know specifically what he's being accused of, but he must know that it's going to be in relation to the sexually charged chat that he had with the person who identified themselves as a minor.
He's then taken in for questioning by Detective Steve Nelson of the Petaluma Police
Department.
That's
futile, bro.
First thing I'm going to do is explain to you your Miranda rights, okay? Okay. You have the right to remain silent.
It's funny that they Mirandize him kind of after the fact, after they've already been, like, talking to him for a while.
First, the doctor agrees to talk.
Yeah, he's just despondent there.
I'd like to talk about what happened today, okay?
But he quickly changes his mind.
What screen name do you use? I really need to have an attorney.
Yeah. He's right. He should have had. I'm glad that he didn't in this moment. I'm glad that he said what he did. But he should have had an attorney. And you know, the attorney that this guy hired was not just an average attorney. Maurice Wolin hired Blair Beck, a Harvard graduate, and a celebrity attorney, like an attorney who specifically kind of deals with celebrities. This lawyer that he hired had also represented Harvey Weinstein, fucking Leonardo DiCaprio, like Mel Gibson. He hired a very high-powered and high-cost attorney who was able to do a lot on his behalf. But yeah, it's kind of crazy. This guy had the resources to hire an attorney like that, and yet he's going to talk and, like, kind of undermine the very efforts that she's going to be trying to fucking do.
Okay. Okay.
But despite asking for an attorney, he chooses to keep talking.
You asked to talk to him.
Smart. It's because the cops are exactly... So that's exactly what the officers are trying to get. So you'd have a suspect, and you'd kind of, like, have a few officers be dicks to him, and then it's like the good cop, bad cop, and then you have this other detective or this other officer come out and then kind of start talking to him, like asking him how he's doing, maybe offering him water, like trying to gain his trust essentially, and then you just talk to him, kind of talk to him and try and get him to like to open up to you.
Attorney, yes. Okay, I'm not going to discuss this further because I can't, unless you want to waive your right.
Yeah.
To have an attorney present.
Smart. And even the tone that this officer is using, it's soft. It's not intimidating. He's being respectful. The cop even had his hands up in kind of this gesture, like, I'm giving you space.
Okay. I'm not going to discuss this further because
the cop's hands are going up to put a kind of distance in between Wolin and himself. He's saying, if you want to talk to your attorney, I'll back off. And then he puts his hand up to kind of symbolize the backing off. Even though the cop wants to talk to Wolin, the cop doesn't want to have to end the conversation. The cops do not want lawyers to get involved, right? Because the lawyer is going to say, shut up, and then I'll see you like in a few hours or a few days or whatever. But no, the cop is doing an excellent job of gaining this fucking idiot's trust.
Unless you want to waive your...
Or this fucking intelligent... I don't know, this guy, I don't even know what the fuck to categorize him as.
To have an attorney present.
The detective asks him four more times if he's waiving his right to an attorney.
I will answer what I can.
But you can.
And each time he agrees and continues to talk.
I'm not going to play games
I'm
here.
I'm not playing games. I'm scared out of my mind.
Yeah, right. He's scared. And when he says that, so what Wolin's saying is, please assuage my fear. Wolin's saying, I'm very scared, so please tell me it's going to be okay. Tell me it's going to be okay. Tell me by talking to you that it's going to be okay.
And I understand that.
Yeah, I understand
that. You saw
that.
My record. I've never done anything wrong in my life.
What a bullshit, dude. You've never done anything wrong.
You saw my record. I've never done anything wrong.
See, so you don't just get to this position, right? So Wolin had had two interactions, he talked to two separate decoys. So immediately, if I were the cop, like, well, I guess you wouldn't want this guy to get defensive, but this is obviously untrue because Wolin had solicited two online underage decoys. So for him to say, I've never done anything wrong in my life, bullshit. You did this exact same thing with a separate decoy like days before. And that's obviously, this is a kind of hyperbolic, nonsensical statement. Like, everyone kind of does things that are fucked up probably. Like, obviously not to this magnitude, but it's pretty ridiculous to say I've never done anything wrong in my life. Like, what are you, dude? I'm not religious, but it's like, are you the next manifestation of Christ? Isn't that what they said about Jesus? They never did anything wrong in his life.
Okay. And now being charged with very serious offenses.
Yeah.
Why did you come to the house in Petaluma today?
I was curious.
He's Dan Allen. It was curiosity that they brought me here.
About what? I chatted with someone online.
Curious. So this dude's gonna say it was just science. He's like, I'm just a curious mind of a scientist. I had to know.
She had asked to meet me on several occasions. I declined.
And that's true. He declined because of fear. He declined because he is somewhat intelligent, right? Like he recognizes that what he was doing was something that could get his ass in jail. He knew that and he was scared, but it was still his horniness that kept him coming back, that kept him still hitting up the decoy. And it was him who had hit up the decoy multiple times after they stopped talking briefly.
And today again, she asked. I had a little bit of time, not very much.
Okay.
And so I thought
it's a joke. His attorney later would argue too in court that that the decoy bullied him into coming and kind of made fun of him, which is a fucking joke. Like the decoy just did the typical like, oh, come on, you're a faker, like just come through. But that to say that a fucking 13-year-old hypothetical decoy like bullied you is just pathetic, especially if you're a dude in this kind of fucking standing.
Okay.
The doctor is referring to how online he made a date for sex with a decoy, but chickened out.
Yeah.
Then the decoy, deliberately behaving like a precocious teenager, encouraged him to come.
I know she was young, and I knew that.
Bam, you knew she was young. So if you knew she was young, and then we consider all of the things you said in your chat, then you clearly have demonstrated intent.
Okay. Did you talk to her about touching and kissing and
yes,
making each
did.
Other feel good? I remember she saying that she had trouble finding something to make her feel good.
That's not
okay.
I was playing with it. That's
fact,
a horrible thing to say.
What he said online
You're
was,
a fucking idiot.
I work hard to make the girl feel good. I wouldn't stop until you blank.
And that was
over
come. I just
over.
Saw that. He said, I wouldn't stop until you come over and over again. So fucking. Yeah, if you're going to say something
good,
like this,
I wouldn't stop until you
come over and over, like that's obviously demonstrating
blank
sexual intent.
Over and over.
And then you told her, no, I'm real, but you're under 18 and I'm over. We would have to be so careful.
Yeah, he knew.
I don't remember saying that, but I told her that she needed to be, I was concerned about her. She needed to be careful.
Okay.
The only reason
she
I
needed to be careful, he's doing the Daniel Pulido defense.
I was curious, but I wasn't going to do anything.
And he's doing the Dan Allen defense. He's just curious.
Over and over again, I said that, well, I shouldn't come. She should be careful. You're talking
yeah,
about...
Yeah, he shouldn't come. That's interesting that he even says that.
I can tell that over and over again, I said...
I shouldn't come. And you shouldn't have. You shouldn't have. And that merely acknowledges that he knew what he was doing was wrong. He knew what he was doing was criminal and wrong.
She should be careful.
You're talking about that you want her to take your pants off.
When? You can take mine off if you want. How do you want to do it?
I wasn't going to do anything.
He's just repeating that.
That was not appropriate. Officer Nelson,
And there we go. So Officer Nelson, so we don't have the entire unedited interaction between the two. But it's very interesting that Maurice Wolin addresses him as Officer Nelson. So Nelson is probably his last name. It's not like he's calling him like Joe or something. But nonetheless, to even address him like that, Maurice Wolin is probably used to a certain amount of respect just because he's a doctor. Being a doctor is hard, and doctors oftentimes get respect. Like I used to work in a medical type field where sometimes I'd interact with doctors and like, I guess it kind of makes sense, but it's like a lot of the doctors that I interacted with, they just carried themselves in a way to let people know that they were important. Like, I don't want to say that they were like arrogant douchebags, but like, I guess kind of like they let people know like they were, you know, important people, kind of just in the way that they would carry themselves. So he must be used to that kind of thing. And now, even still, he's not going to immediately humble himself. He's probably incapable of humbling himself because his position in life, because of his money and his job, because he's been so used to being on top of his life. It's probably going to be very, and it probably was very difficult for him to adjust to the 3 months of prison that he did or whatever.
I shouldn't have talked to her. Right. I wasn't going to do anything.
So you drove 40 minutes from Piedmont.
So what, is it that he didn't do anything or he wasn't going to do anything? Because those things are different as well.
To meet a 13-year-old.
Yes, he did.
Nothing would have happened.
expect me to believe that? After you talk about having different sexual acts with her?
Yeah, he's already made up in his mind that he's going to lie at this point.
And I know that doesn't make it right, but... All right, the time's approximately 14:38. Conclude the interview, and I call him. I'll walk you over to the trailer.
Once he's taken out of the interrogation room, an officer dials the doctor's wife and hands him the phone.
For the phone call from hell.
I'm in big trouble. I'll explain. You have to bail me out of this county
you have jail. And that's he says, you have to bail me out. He's not like, babe, can you bail me out? Like, I think he's aware that if he explains the entirety of the situation, like, he might not get bailed out. So he's like, hey, just bail me out. I'll explain when you get here after you've paid, but first just pay.
$30,000 check we'll need.
Yeah, it's a lot. This dude obviously had money. They can just like pull this out to go drop off to pay a cash bond for this guy.
It was a sting operation. I'll explain it to you. Don't bring the girls. I didn't do anything, but I did something stupid.
The men in this investigation were charged.
And I think the last takeaway that we can get from this fucker is that he is one of the best representations of the Streisand effect that we've seen in TCAP. So the Streisand effect is basically a social phenomena in which people want to see what they're not supposed to see. Like, it's named after Barbra Streisand and a picture that was taken of her house that she tried to suppress, but her attempts to suppress this picture only led to more public interest in it. Similar, Maurice Wolin, all the attempts that he made online to defend himself and all of the bullshit arguments that he tried to have his lawyer make in court, like, all of them were attempts to exonerate him and to basically suppress what had happened on TCAP, yet all of these efforts merely made him a more interesting and fucking laughable character. It's pretty ridiculous. So yeah, this was Maurice Wolin. Let me know what you guys think in the comments below, and until next time.